Good afternoon. Welcome to the briefing. As we mentioned on Tuesday, we're going to start the briefing today with a rundown on the activities at Tooele. Briefing will be given by Dr. Ted Prosef, who is the Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Chemical and Biological Matters, and Mr. Gil Deckert, who is the Assistant Secretary of the Army for Research, Development, and Acquisition. Before I turn over the podium, I'd just like to point out that following this portion of the briefing, I'll come back up to answer any questions on other subjects you may have. And with that, I'll turn things over to Dr. Prosef.
Okay, I want to thank you all for coming. This is a very exciting day for us. You're getting an information packet being passed around now, so a lot of the information, if you'd page through that, related to the program is in there, but we'll be happy to answer any questions that you'll have. Today, we're delighted to report that the operations at Tooele Destruction Facility, the chemical destruction facility, have commenced. We have processed the first rocket. We've analyzed the data. Things are going very, very well. As you know, Tooele is our largest storage site in continental United States. We have about 44% of the current stockpile there. Tooele also has a good variety of different chemical agents and chemical munitions, so we're going to learn a lot about how to process those. We're also going to use a lot of information which we've gained and learned from the Johnson Island destruction process. That also was a very successful process. I would like to also take this opportunity to commend the Army. The way it works in this building, we at OSD are the oversight managers for the program, and the Army is our executive agent, so the Army has the responsibility for the actual execution. And I'd like to commend the Army for the outstanding work they've done, specifically in developing the type of technology they did and all the activities that associated with that. Also for the good outreach that they did with the state local officials and the environmental officials and getting the permits and getting the people to understand what we've done out there. Like I said, it's an exciting time for us. This is the first continental United States plant. It's a big moment. It's been a lot of years in going. We expect that we will be done with this entire demilitarization program nationally by the year 2004. We're shooting for that date. This is a good start, and it's been a good first day. So without belaboring that anymore, I'll ask the Army to come up here. This is Mr. Gil Decker, who's been introduced earlier. He's the Assistant Secretary of the Army for Research, Development, and Acquisition, and also the Acquisition Executive for the Army. The operations are directly under his control.
Thanks very much, Ted, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We're appreciative that you came today. We hope we can inform you of both in general and in detail and respond to your questions on where we are and where we're going on the program. As Ted said, we began operations today to eliminate the chemical weapons stored at the Tooele Army Depot in Utah. Just as a quickie, this is an overview of the chemical demilitarization facility, a very high-tech plant that's just adjacent to the bunkers and the storage area where the weapons are stored. And I won't take you through this in detail. I'm probably better suited to answer any of the specific questions. I am indeed pleased. It's a major milestone for the residents of Utah, particularly the local community and county of Tooele. And it's certainly a major milestone for the Department of Defense. And last but not least, it's really a milestone for the international community. These class of weapons, often referred to in addition to nuclear weapons as weapons of mass destruction, are pretty awful things. And we here in the United States are moving toward becoming a signatory to a treaty that will cause these weapons to disappear for all countries that sign the treaty. In anticipation of that, and even before that, we have laws that direct us to demilitarize and destroy these weapons by the year 2004. And we are endeavoring to make that date but not at the risk of public safety, and I'll comment on that in a few minutes. Substantial risk analyses, and I admit they are sometimes debated and controversial, but we have used the very latest in risk assessment models and technology that we know about, and we constantly update if new information comes in our risk assessments. The bottom line conclusion of these, each risk assessment is done on a site-specific basis, is that continued long-term storage of these aging munitions pose a greater overall risk to the surrounding environment and the public than the risk of going ahead with the disposal. And today we have started down the risk reduction curve. The startup, as Dr. Prosoff pointed out, follows a lengthy period of pre-operational equipment and systems testing, which proved out the operational training, proved out the design. We made fixes during testing where we found flaws. We brought together all of the data we learned from the Johnson Island, JCADS, ATOL chemical facility, which was serial one, which is operating successfully as we speak. And with that data, we have gone through an exhaustive, thorough, and rigorous regulatory permitting process with every intent of volunteering information, providing mandatory information, and meeting the requirements of both the federal and state laws. We were granted the permit to begin trial burn operation early in July, and a suit was brought for a preliminary injunction to halt the start of that facility. We voluntarily postponed operations for almost 2 months until the court could act. And at the end of that period, a federal district court recently declined to halt the startup of the facility and did not grant the preliminary injunction. And so we began plans to proceed with our operation. Late this past Tuesday, the same groups that brought the suit in federal court for the preliminary injunction filed a motion with the Utah Solid and Hazardous Waste Control Board to stop agent burning. The hearing on that is being held as we speak, and perhaps we'll have some information from that hearing before this press conference is over. In accordance with our permit and with the fact that the federal court did not issue an injunction, and we've received no further word from the Board of Utah, we proceed in accordance with the state's prior approval. And at approximately 9:35 this morning, Washington time, the first nerve agent-filled M55 rocket was destroyed. This is the first weapon in our trial burn sequence of the approved permit. It poses the greatest storage risk. And I'll take a second to point out to you in real quick terms what an M55 rocket looked like. Now rest assured, this one has nothing in it.
Easy for you to say.
Believe me, I wouldn't be this close if it did. These come in a canister that are the shipment container for these when they were envisioned to be used as weapons, and you see it out of the canister. The front end is the area that contains the nerve agent. It's roughly a quart, maybe a little more, a little less. And that's a lot of nerve agent. And then the middle section is the propellant that boosts the rocket out and shoots it off. And it has the guidance fins, and then there's a fusing mechanism here to splatter it when it hits the distant end. So this is what the rocket is, and just in the design of the original weapon, it's all welded together in one piece. So it's not a simple matter of unscrewing. And because of that, this stuff is all stored together in storage, and these rockets are aging. They are clearly, by all estimates of everything that we've done, the most dangerous storage safety risk. And so we're doing a very slow start-up process of operations on our first trial burn.
What is a nerve agent? How many things do you have?
A nerve agent, there are several kinds. This happens to be GB. I'm not a chemical engineer. I am a technical person. I'm going to let Dr. Prosoff, who is a PhD chemical engineer and has been in this business a long time, answer that question.
Yeah, throughout the stockpile, well, maybe I should introduce General Friel before I do this. General Friel here, he is the steward of the stockpile. Perhaps I could direct a question to to you on the numbers of the M-55 rockets. There's 17,000 in Tooele?
The specific numbers for Tooele, GB M-55 rockets, is 28,900, roughly. It's 945 to be exact, but as of now, it's probably about 925. For the specific question on nerve agent, I'm also a chemical officer, and GB, which is the non-persistent agent that's being destroyed now, is a fairly volatile nerve agent versus the VX, which is a much more persistent. This vaporizes very rapidly and dissipates.
Well, let's stop you. How do they compare to sarin and hydrocyanic acid, for instance?
It is sarin. Yes, indeed.
Now, I could ask while you're up there, General. You say destroyed, destroying the Sera agent by burning. Let me ask you about the byproducts. Is this burning going to render this agent completely harmless? Is that possible? And at what temperatures? And can you tell us a little about that process?
I'd like Dr. Post, sure, explain the incineration process.
Let me tell you a little bit about the chemistry. We've done exhaustive work since the early 70s on the different types of destruction processes that can be very useful. We've chosen the incineration process because, to us, that produced the most effective disassociation of the molecules, a way that it can't be recombined, and a way that the products are environmentally compatible. So the products that we're going to be generating, like phosphorus pentoxide, water, carbon dioxide, et cetera, are going to be essentially environmentally compatible. We also have a PAS designed. I thought we had a picture of it, but we don't. But our air treatment air treatment design that comes out of that plant is designed to take out any residual amount of anything, including chemical agents, any residue that might have gotten out. The chances of anything getting out are virtually impossible. The temperatures are very, very high. I can't quote you the number right now. And the residence time is such that we've designed it to make sure that anything that goes through that incinerator will get destroyed.
So you say this is non-environmentally degrading byproduct, completely compatible with the atmosphere?
The bulk of the byproducts are, that's right. The ones that aren't, we scrub out and we reduce so nothing comes out the stack, essentially.
So you're saying then those residuals in the burning chamber, in the stacks, are also going to be taken care of?
That's right. We meet every federal, local, and state guideline, environmental guideline for emissions. And we've done that deliberately to make sure that we're good stewards of the environment.
Completely sure of this from your testing?
From what we've seen, that's correct. We have quite a bit of experience at Johnson Island to see what we've released. So we're very confident we can meet all the guidelines, federal, state, and local.
Problems at Johnson Island. Didn't you? You had one shell running into another and it exploded, although it was contained. Did you have some difficulties in Johnson Island?
As Mr. Decker said, Johnson Island was serial number one. It was the first time we've done that. What we found at Johnson Island, yes, we did have a couple of malfunctions of munitions and a couple of releases, but the systems that we designed worked. Everything was contained. Nothing was released. There was no harm done to the environment or any of the individuals that work and live on the island. So the safety, the redundancy that we built into that plant and the safety considerations we've put in, we've looked at the risk of every possible event happening, and we believe we've designed away any possible hazard that might occur.
Could you explain what the risks of leakage of the rockets are?
The risk of leakage of the chemical agent, the chemical GB, is probably twofold. If it's a local leak inside the bunker because of seepage from the front part of the container itself, the main hazard that poses to somebody in immediate proximity. And so with the worker safety situations there that working around those are very carefully controlled. We have monitors in every one of the bunkers. It's monitored continuously. Very low level of leakage is detected if it happens, and then the right safety response teams and the right kind of equipment can take care of that and remove that one item. The greater risk is one we don't have a good handle on. We've run a number of tests. It's an unknown unknown. And that is, over time, if the agent, and the rocket decays with age, if the agent leaks into the propellant, which is an explosive, what's the instability factor that creates in the propellant? And there are many different forecast estimates of that. We're running a number of tests on that. And I'll come to this curve in just a minute. We don't really have a good handle. We have estimates on what the ultimate shelf life is and what the instability and the likelihood of an explosion of the rocket is in that eventuality. The third element of risk are external events that could create an ignition of the rockets in proximity to other rockets. And that's a very great hazard. And that's site-specific. That could be due to any number of factors that are put into the risk analyses. Now, the results of that kind of analysis show up this kind of a curve. This is a conceptual curve, but we have actual data on real curves in our risk analyses for each site. And the way you need to look at this curve is to take long periods of storage where you're doing no demil and look at all the factors. Building decay, munitions container decay that I sort of described, potentiality of terrorist attacks, accidents, natural catastrophes. Some of these vary at site specific, and you put those into all your risk models and you ask yourself the question over a long period of time, and you can take 5, 10, 15, 20 years, and you can calculate the estimated numbers. What's the probability there'll be at least one serious incident? You see the risk growing with age and continued storage. You then analyze these same factors and events that might get at you during the handling and on-site disposal. And as you calculate those risks, the risks begin to diminish with time until you've finally done 100% of the demil. And that's the differential risk. And it gets greater with time because the risk diminishes by definition in the calculations as you begin to complete your demilitarization.
How many weapons are leaking?
I don't know the exact number. There have been a few leakers. Do you know offhand?
I have the exact numbers.
Okay.
The total number of GB rockets that have leaked at Tooele Army Depot is 602 as of yesterday. This past year, we've had 23 leakers, GB rockets, these very rockets.
Let me make something clear, though. A leaker is defined by a weapon where we get an indication on a very, very sensitive detector. Please don't think of a leaker as something that's sitting there dripping chemical agent. We go in and routinely, with our monitors, check the stockpile. What we might find periodically is a detection at a seam, possibly. See, these are aluminum warheads. The agent, when it degrades, becomes acid, starts to eat at the seams and such. When we detect something, it's well below any effects level. There's no harm to any individual or any release to the environment when we do detect it. So please don't think a leaker is something like you have in your plumbing at home. It really is a detection that we get on a very sophisticated instrument. We then overpack it, seal it, and protect it from leaking any further.
Could you tell me what the Defense Department's policy is on binary weapons? Would those be eventually, it's planned to eventually destroy those as well, and are they part of the operational inventory of the service, the Army now?
Yes, the binary stockpile, which is a very small stockpile, is part of something we call the non-stockpile program. It's a sister program to this one, also run by the same program office. In the non-stockpile program, we're required to destroy the binaries, destroy old production facilities, filling equipment, anything that may give us reason to maybe start up another program, which we have no intention of doing. So that we are planning to destroy those, but under a parallel program with this one.
I believe the program was
recently made subject to DAB review. Has the Defense Acquisition Board met on this program and validated the program cost?
Yes, the Defense Acquisition Board has met. Actually, this is the second year that it's been designated as an MCAT-1D. It's treated just like any other major weapon systems in the Pentagon. An acquisition program baseline has been developed, and that is being adjusted for differences in the program, and we should have a final one this year.
Do you have a cost
now? The cost that we are projecting, the official budget for this program is $10.2 billion. We are projecting a $12 billion cost because of changes in schedules that have happened because of environmental permitting and various other reasons.
The official DAB, where we'll solidify and ratify our best estimate of program baselines, will be next March. But we are working those baselines and adjusting schedules as we go when we have external events, delays, and permits. And Ted is right. The current unofficial baseline is in excess of $12 billion for all the eight sites finished complete. Yes, ma'am.
Now that Tooele is online, can you tell us, is Umatilla next, and what's the date on that? What's the next step?
The macro schedule of the program, it's really eight schedules for eight sites. There are three active permits being processed as we speak. Anniston in Alabama, Pine Bluff, Arsenal in Arkansas, and as you pointed out, Umatilla in Eastern Oregon. They're in varying stages of processing. These are all permits to receive permission to construct the facility. And I want to make sure we leave nothing open for conjecture. We had that permit to build Tooele, but it requires addendums and proving out of the facility before you're allowed to go operational. And that's what we've been doing in Tooele the last few months, last year. The permitting process in the other three sites is the permit to build. And each state has its own nuances of permitting when you finally go operational, but you sort of go through the whole thing again to prove out the plant once it's built. So I want to make that point. There's nothing ever out of control here. The Anniston permit is moving along. We've had to make some changes in it due to some changes in interpretations of some data for the health risk protocols. That'll be resubmitted recently. In Oregon, the permit was accepted. Accepting a permit doesn't mean it's approved. It means we think you're complete, and now we'll begin our processing of the permit. The permit was accepted, and Oregon requires a 45-day mandatory public hearing, public comment period. At the completion of that, there was a substantial amount of debate and contention from different elements that we should wait and see if the National Research Council, which is part of the National Academy of Sciences study on alternative technologies that comes out in the not-distant future, would shed any new light on their deliberations. It won't, and I can explain why later. But nonetheless, the governor, and in good faith, this is not a contentious debate between us, extended the public comment period till the middle of November, at which time we will disclose publicly, as soon as we receive it with the National Research Council sanction, what we've learned about the alternative technologies and what our plans are. That specific assessment of alternative technologies was addressed to the bulk agent only, which is two sites, and not to the explosives and the energetics. So we don't believe it will shed too much light on the existing permitting application.
If you're going to destroy everything by the year 2004, how many sites do you actually need to do that?
Eight. Well, yeah. One at nine, but one's already in operation, and that's Johnson
Eight
Island.
More.
No, Tooele plus seven.
Tooele plus seven. So you need permits for all seven
that's
in
correct.
Order to meet that.
That's correct.
Give us where the others are.
Those are the three I'm most familiar with because those permit applications are active and moving along.
There should be a piece of a schedule chart in your.
Yeah, I just don't recall the exact dates of submission. Let me interject just a moment. This wasn't staged. It just got handed to me about a half hour ago. The board on the appeal that was filed Tuesday night, the Environmental Oversight Board in Utah, held their hearing at 9 o'clock Utah time this morning, and apparently they concluded about a half hour ago, and they have denied the stay. So until further action comes of a major lawsuit or anything, we are free to continue to operate at Tooele.
Can you talk to us about about the historical significance of starting to chop these things up in this plant today in terms of the scope of a weapon system which has been in the inventory for the last, since World War I, basically?
I can give you the status of everything today. Off the top of my head, I can't give you the aging charts for each of the weapons. We have that data, I just don't have it. But in the gross aggregation, Tooele has measured in poundage of the different agents, has about 43% of the stockpile at all eight of the sites. Actually, all nine if you count Johnson Island. Now, that percentage has changed a bit as Johnson Island begins to destroy and your total goes down. But for at the beginning, it was around 43% of the total agent. And Tooele also, and so measured in terms of the kinds of chemical agent and the tons of agent, not the tons of dunnage and everything, we will be almost half done in terms of total amounts of these weapons and the tonnage of agent when we finish at Tooele. So that's obviously why it was selected first.
There obviously have been chemical weapons in the inventory for many, many years, and there was a necessity to dispose of those weapons after World War I, for example. How did they used to do it? Dump them in the ocean? Bury them in the ground? What's the old technique for getting rid of this
stuff? The old technique would not at all be acceptable today, but Ted's been in this business a lot longer than I. Let me defer to him again.
We have had trials on ocean dumping. The ocean dumping was not acceptable to us, mostly because of public concerns, because...
Historically, that's how we used to do it.
We only had trials. We were experimenting with it. We never actually did it. A lot of the munitions were open pit burned in the 60s and 70s, which is unacceptable today. But it was done in remote areas and in deserts and such. So it was done with the rules of employment. Now, a lot of those pits we go back into now, and we're reclaiming a lot of the material, cleaning it up and making sure that we haven't left any residue. The real historical significance of Tooele operating is that the Army decided that this was not a weapon that we needed anymore in our tactical arsenal. These rockets are over 40 years old. They were never designed to be 40 years in storage. We have sat on this stockpile. It was not a problem until about 10 years ago when the deterioration started to show up more and more. So really the historical significance is that this program office, which has been around since, I believe, 1972, this is the first destruction in the continental United States of these weapons, and we're really excited about this. It took this long to get here because we made a conscious effort to make sure that we complied with every rule, regulation, every public concern. We created an outreach program. We're taking everybody's considerations into mind in destroying this, and I think this is the culmination of that success.
Roughly what percentage are obsolete and what percentage could be used if the United States had decided to be a chemical weapon nation instead of...
I can't give you the exact percentages, but the policy is that none of these will be used. We will not retaliate.
What percentage are being destroyed because they're obsolete, couldn't be used anyway? What percentage could be used, but they're being destroyed also?
I'll have to get you that answer. I just don't have that answer.
Did you finish that? The policy is that you would never use these, even in retaliation.
That's right.
In the Gulf War, were they ever transported into theater?
I'm sorry?
Were chemical weapons ever put into theater in the Gulf War?
No. There was no chemical weapons on our side in the theater at all.
Is your goal then the total destruction of the entire stockpile?
Absolutely. 100%.
Including the binary.
I might augment, so there's no doubt about that. We in DOD had advocated for some time and received permission from the National Security Council a few months ago to publicize the exact mix and content of the stockpile at each and every site. That is now public data. That's hard inventory numbers, and if we're successful, 100% of that is destroyed at the end of this period.
When is the last time they were deployed in theater? Was it Korea that we deployed them in Vietnam?
I want to be real careful of your question. There's a difference in the word deployed versus used. So please permit me to make sure that's not
the second part of the question. The last time they were used was World War I.
Maybe in World War II. I'm not sure. World War I, we all know they were used. I don't have
not by us.
No, by the United States. When's the last time
World War I? Never.
I don't know if we did it in World War
I. World War I, we
used. Sure we did.
The Germans used, maybe I'm not as good a student of history, but I understand the Germans used chlorine. They developed the sarin, mustard. There was no American use that I know of. Now, you're talking about riot control agents, things like that. I believe there is.
World War One.
We'll have to find that for you. I don't believe that. I don't remember ever reading about anything like
but
that. But I'm not a student of history.
To answer your question, now that we made sure our semantics are right, deployed means put into theater and stored carefully and everything. They were stored in Europe, in the NATO, in Germany. Stockpile in Germany is what was moved to Johnson Island 100%. And how long ago was that, Ted?
2 years ago.
You remember, George?
I absolutely do. I took them back.
Okay. So there are zero deployed now.
The only time we've deployed weapons forward was in Europe, and those were stored there for many years, and they were returned in 1990, and most of those have been destroyed already at Johnson Island.
General, in my flamboyant youth, when I was a young chemical warfare technician in the late 40s, after World War II, we had such gases as phosgene, chloropicrin, lewisite. You never hear of these anymore. Do they still exist? Are they in storage at these places?
There is a small amount of some of the exotic agents still maintained, primarily so we can test our instrumentation and detectors in case an enemy would choose to use them against us. And those are called research and development stockpiles. And there's a small quantity of phosgene that's still left at Tooele, and that was used primarily as part of the experimentation in the demilitarization process. Those agents have since been destroyed. Most of those were converted. For example, phosgene was converted to a commercial chemical and sold as a product. It's readily available on the open market. The other agents were all of our experimental agents and the old agents that were not part of our stockpile were destroyed at Pine Bluff or at Tooele.
Do you know whether the United States has ever used chemical weapons in combat?
Not since I've been in the uniform, but I will tell you that we did during the First World War provide substantial agents to the British, and we were part of the first gas regiment. And if you call that U.S. use, it's probably prudent for us to admit that we did, in fact, assist the British, if not actually use them during the First World War early. But that was a different world and a different war, and we were being subjected to massive use by the Germans at that time. And primarily that was in Belgium.
What's the connection, if any, between what we're doing with our stockpile and this chemical weapons treaty that's out there and hasn't been ratified by enough countries yet?
Yeah, the Chemical Weapons Convention, you know, is up before Congress for ratification, hopefully this September, this fall. The Chemical Weapons Convention itself requires that when it enters into force, that each country that has a stockpile has 10 years plus the 6 months of the entry into force position to destroy the stockpile. If we ratify this year, or when we ratify this year, we're enthusiastic about that also. 2007 will become a treaty deadline. However, we are still sticking to our 2004 deadline because we really have unilaterally decided to destroy the weapon stockpile. But that's the connection. It sets a timetable on us, but we should be done well before that.
What would be left of that after you finish the incineration? About how much, and is it in a liquid form, or is it, what is it?
The metal is charred metal. I mean, it changes shape, it's so hot, but everything attached to that metal has been decomposed by the process of incineration.
Same volume, but in a brick.
It won't quite be a brick. It's just a scrap metal, and it literally is scrap metal. And we sample test it, and if it's classified properly, it is safe to sell as scrap metal, and indeed that's what we're doing at Johnson Island. The agent, which goes to what we call the liquid incinerator, is decomposed into these various constituencies that Ted described a little earlier, is essentially a brine type of salt as a solid. It will be treated as a hazard waste for safety purposes, but not a toxic waste. And it's under normal hazard waste rules and will be disposed of according to those methods. And the explosive, the energetic, is like any other explosive. It's like what's left when you shoot off a firecracker. The reason that we're incinerating it is the eventuality there may have been some leakage of agent into the explosive, but it's just an ash.
Let me get this gentleman here, and then I'll get to you. He's going to have his hand up for a while.
You mentioned that the stockpile in Germany was transported to Johnston in 1990. Considering some of the concerns on the part of environmental groups and civilians living in the areas of the stockpile, stockpiles. Did the Army ever look at possibly transporting the stockpile to one location and getting rid of it all in one place?
Yes, in the mid-70s, that was evaluated. And based on the risk assessment that it was done at that time, the Army concluded, with the help of the Academy of Sciences, that we really needed to have 8 locations in the United States and not transport.
Because of the risk of transporting?
That's right. It was the risk assessment, basically. This is not a financial consideration. It was definitely a risk.
So, a body of law that is built up around these sites, isn't there state, local, county, and federal law, which makes it virtually impossible for you guys to move this stuff?
Right. We, until last year, we actually had a law that prohibited us from studying transportation. And that law has law had to be renewed every year. Congress this year did not renew that law. It doesn't affect us anyway, but you're right.
A related question. Is there any request or thought about transporting agents from other countries that might sign the convention? This is obviously a very sophisticated, high-tech operation to destroy these weapons. Perhaps not every country would be willing to spend that kind of money.
As long as we're talking law, there is a law that prohibits us from using these facilities for anything but the stockpile on the site. So what we have to do when we're done with these facilities is essentially dismantle them and ensure that nothing else can be processed. As you know, the communities are worried that we'll start bringing hazardous materials into their sites. We're protected against doing that. So there's no consideration of moving stuff.
Would you correct me? Historically, if I remember correctly, at the end of World War II, the United States was the only country that was not a signatory to the Geneva Pact against the use of chemical weapons. Has that changed?
That was biological weapons, wasn't it? I'm a treaty guy here.
'75 was ratified by the U.S.
Which?
The Geneva Protocol, I think he's addressing.
Okay. The Geneva Protocol was ratified, if that's the one you're talking about.
Chemical and biological.
Yeah, 1975. Yeah. Thank you.
And small amounts will still be maintained in laboratory settings for research on prevention and serums?
Yeah, correct me if I'm wrong. I'm not really the treaty expert. I have one here. But I believe that each country is allowed to maintain up to a ton. One metric ton for defensive purposes, research and development.
Research and development, yes. And that would be Aberdeen and
one site. One large site, one small production site for testing. And between those two sites, that will be it.
Has the Senate ratified the Chemical Weapons Convention?
No, it's coming up this fall.
It did move out of the Foreign Relations Committee, but it has not reached the floor for full ratification.
It won't really affect you one way or the other, will it?
Well, and under current policies and current law, we are aiming toward meeting the law of having the job done by 2004. But I want to say very publicly, it is the policy of the Department of Defense, and unless higher authority overrules us, the law also states a doctrine of maximum public protection. Now, that's even more stern than handling nuclear materials. Nuclear materials only require reasonable assurance. Now, although different numbers can get applied, and everybody agrees that maximum public safety is a stronger doctrinal law than reasonable safety, were there to be a conflict, it is the policy until somebody that's our bosses tells us different that the safety will govern.
Well, in order to the 2002 deadline, would you...
2004.
You'd have to operate the plant 24 hours a day. There's really no room for glitches, is there?
There's a certain contingency built into all of this. If we gain the efficiencies in production... See, we were very conservative in designing these plants and these schedules. What we learned in Johnson Island is that we could gain some efficiency in production rate. If that proves out true in continental United States, we should be able to finish even earlier. So we're real enthusiastic about that.
You'll be destroying it one day at any one of these sites, several hundred
It's different for every configuration, because in addition to having rockets, in addition to and various kinds of artillery shells, I think we have 3 configurations of artillery. We also have mines. We also have bulk and ton containers. So it's hard to tell you what the production rate can be. We have it for each agent. If you want that, we can bring that out later on.
I'd like to interject just one thing on that issue. This is far more informative of you than completing prepared remarks. I think they're going to be handed out to you anyway. But let me make one comment. Take Tooele, a specific example. Our permit to proceed, which was approved in early July, didn't open the door and say, go to it, we'll see you later. It's a very meticulous plan for each kind of agent, starting with the rockets first, to do a trial burn. Real agent, real process. We do trial burns at slow rates. We deliberately do not inject to maximum capable rate of the factory, because during the early parts of the trial burns, we're taking time out to do laboratory analysis of the residual and to monitor the stacks to make sure everything we've told you is being measured correctly that way. And so we have to take that data that comes out of these slow burns, slow processes, analyze it, and update our risk analyses and submit to the Utah Regulatory Quality Assurance Board. They will look at that, and after the trial burn is completed, we will then receive, assuming there's no problem, and we have shown that the data supports our expectations, we then can go to the full rate, and we will complete the rockets. They'll be done.
When is that?
It'll be 5 or 6 months of trial burns at varying rates to gather data and make sure. Then we go to full rate, and I'm guessing it's probably several months after that. I just don't recall. It's of that order. We can get you that data. And so then we go to trial burn two, which won't be as complex a weapon as the rockets, and we do a similar trial burn this period, and I forget, it probably won't be quite as long as the rockets, prove out that's working, then we go to full rate. And that's a series of steps we take until we're done, and our scheduling and assessment of the plant capacity, including the time to do the trial burns at the schedule we're now on, will fit into the 2002 schedule for Tooele. 2004 is a total program. 2002 is what we have scheduled for Tooele.
General,
thank you.
These gentlemen have to kind of move on, although they are available to answer additional questions. Why don't we take a break here, and then we can, in about 2 minutes, I'll step up there. And if anybody has any questions, if we can, further questions for these gents that you want to handle offline, we'll try and line up somebody for you.
Thank you very much.
Everything out of your way? I'll get this. I'll give you some more.
So we go to the
That could be very long. Are you looking for Mike?
I need you to step outside if you're not going to be part of this next briefing. Thank you.
Okay, let's reconvene. I have just one announcement that I'd like to make. The Joint Interagency Task Force East will host representatives from more than 40 nations and dependencies during a Caribbean counter-drug orientation visit from August 27th to 29th in Key West, Florida. The orientation visit brings together representatives from Coast Guards, Marine Police, maritime law enforcement, and the militaries of Caribbean nations which have an interest in maritime and aviation counter-drug operations. Retired General Barry McCaffrey, the Director of the Office of National Drug Control Policy, and Robert S. Gelbart, who is the Assistant Secretary of State for International Narcotics and Law Enforcement Affairs, will be among the speakers from the United States. There's a press information center which will be open to assist interested media in covering the event. And more information, you can call the Public Affairs Office at 305-293-5294. And we also have some details on this one in a press advisory. And with that, I would be happy to try and answer some of your questions. Yes, Jamie.
Mike, can you put into context for us this latest report on possible chemical weapons detections during the early part of the Gulf War that was posted on the internet this month?
Yes, Jamie. As you know, we have a very extensive program which the President has directed that we undertake to examine thoroughly the issues concerning illnesses among some of the Gulf War veterans. And as part of that, the Department established an investigative team to examine comprehensively the military records related to the war. The report that was cited in this morning's news account was essentially one which had been put up on GulfLink, which is one of the communications vehicles we use to make sure that this information gets out to people. And it was posted on about the 5th of August. There's really nothing new in this report. In fact, the report, the elements of the report appear in this June 1994 report, which was put together by the Defense Science Board after it became evident to the United States that there had been instances of possible chemical detections during the early part of the air campaign. And what you have in this report today is simply a recapitulation of those early reports that were done primarily by Czech chemical weapons teams, but also by some French chemical weapons teams.
Well, Captain, it seemed to me that I recall that those Czech reports and some of these other ones were checked out and basically ruled false alarms because follow-up reports didn't confirm them. But this report on the, I was reading, termed two of those reports credible, and five other instances it termed not thoroughly substantiated, but could not be discounted.
Right.
Doesn't that seem to indicate that they're putting a little more weight on the credibility of those?
Well, Jamie, we've always been very careful in the way we characterize these reports, primarily because the protocols associated with chemical weapons detections can be very involved, and involve not only an initial detection, but follow-up which can confirm the detection. Unfortunately, in each one of these instances, there is no potential now for any confirmation of the detection. And even at the time, although the in two of the reports, which we term credible, there was a confirmation conducted by the teams which got the initial reading. In the other cases, the five other cases, that was not possible. I want to point out two other things. One is that other than a single U.S. soldier who happened to be accompanying one of these teams on one occasion, there were no U.S. personnel who were in the vicinity of these detections at the times that they occurred. And when the U.S. teams were called in to verify the detections, they were unable to do so. Now, the reason that they were unable to do so was a function of two things. One was the time that had passed between the initial detection and the time that they were called in to confirm the detection. And secondly, the low level of detection, the amounts of agents that were involved, even in the initial detections, were so very low that it was not at all surprising that the agents would have dissipated had they actually been there in the first place.
Well, just to be clear, does the Pentagon now believe that these detections or these cases where detectors went off, believe them to be false alarms or false positives, or do you believe that they were indicative of an actual chemical presence?
We believe in at least two of the cases they were credible detections, but we do not know what it was that was detected or under what circumstances those detections occurred. In other words, we are being very cautious about these incidents, primarily because we do not have any independent confirmation of any aspect of them, other than the fact that we have great confidence in the equipment that the Czech detection unit was using at the time. Now, there are some other important things that I want to point out in connection with these. We, as part of our overall program to look into Gulf War illnesses, we have these investigations that are going on continually. And in fact, you will see additional reports come up on Gulf Link in the future. This just happens to be one of the first ones. But this is just part of our program. Our program is actually a four-part program which involves, first and foremost, treating the troops. And this is a part of the program where we have looked at about 20,000 clinical cases. We've evaluated 20,000 clinical cases in connection with these Gulf War illnesses. The second thing that we're doing is the basic research into possible causes of these Gulf War illnesses. We also have a declassification process going on, and you've seen a lot of the documents which have been declassified that have also been put up on Gulf Link. And the fourth one, the one that I've been talking about, is this investigation team. And the investigation team not only put together this report, this compilation of data which had occurred from reports that were done by the Defense Science Board earlier and by the by other sources, but they are also the group that uncovered the information regarding to the Camisea demolition that was done. And I think that kind of the bottom line to what I'm trying to point out here is that we're trying to find as much information as we can. We're trying to handle the information in a responsible way, but we are also trying to get it out to the public and to concerned veterans so that they can take a look at it.
What do you say to critics, which include members of Congress, some of the Gulf War illness victims and their advocates, who say that the information that's come out in this report and in recent reports over the summer undermine the Pentagon's credibility on this issue?
I frankly don't see how they get to that conclusion, since we have gone out of our way from the very start to make information public related to any of these instances. I was here in the Pentagon when it first became apparent that there were these check detections, and I know we went to great lengths to make certain that not only did veterans groups be made aware of the detections, but that we made it widely and publicly known that these events had occurred. We assembled a special panel. We have a report which many of you have gone over before, from a panel that was headed by Dr. Lederberg of the Defense Science Board, to take a look at this information. And we have spent literally millions of dollars, not only in taking a look at clinically evaluating Gulf War veterans, but also taking every other possible route that we can to uncover any kind of information we can which would be relevant to Gulf War illnesses. And one final point I'd like to make is that there is no country who was involved in the Gulf War which has yet been able to put together one of these detections with any kind of a medical problem which existed with an individual who was exposed to these possible chemical weapons at the time that they of these detections.
Does your research show that in the June 1994 report, you said essentially the same thing, that two reports had some credibility, but the others couldn't be discounted? Or is that a new refinement that you've come up with?
No, if you look at the report, it goes down in about the same way, that those two check reports were the ones that seemed to have the greatest potential for one, they had gone back and they'd been able to confirm with the equipment that they had been able to confirm that they actually did get a reading. In the other cases, they were unable to do that as they went back to try and confirm on a second attempt. And as I say, when the U.S. teams were called in to confirm the reports, we were never able to do so.
If there's no new information in this report that came out on August 5th, why a new report?
Well, we have said that we're going to go through the information. We're going to assemble it in a way that we can put it up on Gulf Link, and we did so. It was certainly indicative of the detail that we are going into in looking over all of the previous reported incidents where there have been any kind of operational reports that may relate or have some future impact on Gulf War illnesses. And our whole goal in this is to put this together in a way that it can be recaptured in the future and can also be made available to others who want to review our data to see if they can shed any new light on Gulf War illnesses. Yes.
Russia?
Is that everything on this one? That's good.
Yes. Mike, was announced at the State Department about an hour and a half ago that the embassy U.S. Embassy in Moscow received the terms, brief outline of the terms of a ceasefire that General Levitt had negotiated near Grozny today. And I would ask you this. Has Secretary Perry spoken with the Defense Minister Igor Rodionov or any others in the defense establishment in Russia regarding the confusion about who has what authority, who's acting under Yeltsin's orders, what are Yeltsin's orders? Do you have any? Was Secretary Perry in touch with the Russians?
No, Secretary Perry has not been in touch with the Russians on this subject. Secretary Perry is taking this week for a little well-deserved vacation, so he has not been in the building.
All right. Are there others in the building that have any?
To my knowledge, we have not been in contact this building on that subject. Yes.
Espionage?
Yes.
It was learned yesterday that an Army private had been arrested and charged with espionage in June. I am curious as to whether there is a policy regarding making public information about people arrested inside the military for espionage or comparable charges. And whether it's the Pentagon's view that this particular case was handled properly.
Because this is an ongoing case, I really can't comment on the specifics of this case. With regard to a policy, I don't believe there is a policy other than under normal circumstances, And unless there is some overriding legal consideration, any kind of a charge, which is essentially criminal in nature, would be made public.
Is there any guidelines, though, on the length in which one?
On guidelines on how long?
By the military, without making such information public?
No, I don't believe that there's any guidelines. The normal procedure would be maximum disclosure as early as possible.
The Army said yesterday that they're under no obligation to make public information about such arrests, and that there's no policy as far as they're concerned about making an announcement of any kind if an Army soldier is arrested for espionage.
Again, I don't want to get involved in this particular case. Other than in a kind of a generalized way, I would just say that it's the policy of the Department of Defense to make maximum disclosure any kind of information that is not classified in nature. Yes.
Do you also know, in general, if there's any guidelines in terms of how long an individual can be held without having any contact, say, with their family? There's been accusations in this case in particular.
In this particular case, again, I think the Army has some people who they can provide you after the briefing who can shed some light on that. Under military law, any soldier who is placed in pretrial confinement has the right to consult with an attorney and to have a military magistrate review the necessity for confinement within 48 hours. And my understanding is that both of those rights occurred in this case.
But there is no standing policy on the release of information other than the general guideline, not specific to
Specifically with regard to this kind of a case. I am not aware of. But if you look at our overall kind of policy regarding release of information, I think that if the bottom line to that is that if it is not classified and if there is a public interest, that it is the policy of the Department of Defense to make it public and to release it to the news media.
Do you know if there's any intention to review the Army's actions in this case? Because the only reason that this did come out was because some documents were made available to a Fayetteville newspaper. And then only in response to questions after great and lengthy delay did the Army admit that they had the gentleman yesterday and had charged him.
I am not aware of any kind of a review that is underway or planned. If there is such a thing, I'll keep you posted.
Different subject?
Anything on the Marine plane?
I don't have a great deal on that one, but let me just give you what I do have. A U.S. Marine Corps FNA-18 disappeared from radar this morning while conducting a routine air training mission approximately 40 miles from Wallops Island, Virginia. The U.S. Coast Guard is currently conducting a search in the area where the aircraft disappeared from radar. The missing aircraft is a single-seat aircraft.
No sign of the pilot?
To my knowledge, as of this moment, there is no sign of the pilot.
Could you tell us if there's also, in this situation, given the number of recent air crashes, whether the secretary or someone in the building intends to make a review of air safety measures? I know Air Combat Command is intending to review safety right. issues on Friday. But it seems that there's been a couple. Tell us if there's also, in this situation, given the number of recent air crashes, whether the secretary or someone in the building intends to make a review of air safety measures. I know Air Combat Command is intending to review safety right. issues on Friday, But it seems that there's been a couple of service-wide problems.
Suzanne, I am not aware of any kind of a review, formal review, that is in the offing in connection with aircraft accidents. I will say that, in general, the department and certainly the services specifically are very interested every time there is an aircraft accident. And for this reason, the services conduct a very extensive aircraft accident investigation. The whole goal of the investigation being to ultimately achieve a zero defect safety record, perfect safety record. Now, as it happens, this year for the Air Force is so far a very safe year. It is even better than last year's, which was a record safety year. But that is not to say we're perfect yet. And as a result of these accidents, there are a number of aircraft accident investigations that are going on, and those accident investigations are reviewed not only by the services, but do come to the department and then are disseminated to others, to the other services that were not involved in the accident, because of the overall goal to try and make sure that everybody has a safe flying environment, one which is accident-free.
Is there any concern, though, that with the drawdown, that there's been too much of a flying op tempo, that people are putting in too many hours?
Well, we certainly are watching that very carefully, but to my knowledge, there is not any evidence that that has played a role in these accidents at this juncture. But again, that's certainly one of the many, many aspects that they will be looking at.
Back to espionage for just a moment.
Yes.
Is it, has the foreign national involved in this situation been placed under arrest or
I have no detail on that at all. I'm sorry, I just don't. Yes.
Back to the crash, F-18.
Yes.
So there's no sign of the pilot.
Right.
Does that mean that there's no sign of the airplane itself either?
They do have a site, but I don't have any specifics on that. I don't know whether there's been any kind of debris that's been sighted. Yes.
Can you explain the Navy's decision to move the Missouri to Honolulu?
I can't, other than the fact that I know that there was a release that was put out last night, and the Navy will, I'm sure, be able to give you a lot of detail about how that process was conducted.
What did Mr. Dalton say in that announcement?
Let me see if I've got a copy of it here. The announcement simply says that the Honorable John H. Dalton announced yesterday that the Navy has selected the USS Missouri Memorial Association, Honolulu, Hawaii, to acquire the historic battleship USS Missouri for use as a memorial and a museum. He went on to say that in addition to Honolulu, organizations in Bremerton, Washington, Long Beach, and San Francisco, California, submitted applications to the Navy. According to Navy officials who evaluated the applications, all of the city's proposals included comprehensive plans to maintain the ship and operate it as a museum and a memorial. Secretary Dalton expressed gratitude for the patriotic expressions of grassroots campaigns and the strong backing from public officials. He said he made the difficult choice only after a detailed evaluation of all the technical, financial, historical, and public interest. This was a very tough decision since all of the proposals were so excellent and impressive. I'm genuinely sorry the Navy doesn't have a USS Missouri to give each of the cities.
Yeah. Yes, Mike. Finally, the Israelis successfully tested an arrow intercepting a Scud, I believe, metal-to-metal impact. Is this interceptor, this anti-ballistic missile, Is that something that the U.S. has got a license to manufacture? Will we have to buy it from Israel, or do you know?
I don't happen to know, but I do know that there are people back in DDI who are up to speed on that one and who could help you.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks.